Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. We're really pleased to have you here at the National World War I Museum. My name's Matt Naylor, and I'm the President and CEO here. Each of you have a drink and some chocolate, but we're going to have you hold those. This is going to be one of those tests in if you can, in fact, last through the evening. So if you can hold on to those, you can pop them under your seat or whatever, but if you'd not eat them and drink them just yet, that'd be great. So on the stage here, we have René Bollier from Andes.
Andres.
Oh, Andres, I'm no sorry. Problem. Oh, whoops, that's, yep,
that's the mints.
There.
Those are the mints.
From Andres. And René began working at the family-owned, operated Andres at aged 5. That was before child labor laws came into effect. Graduate of the University of Kansas, he moved to Switzerland and was able to perfect his technique there, moving back to Kansas City, where he took over as the president of Andres in 2010. Thanks for being with us, René. We have Christopher Elbow here, whose mother named him after a chocolate, is what I hear. Thanks for being with us, Chris. Lincoln Country Club is where he got his start cooking there whilst attending the University of Nebraska, and has really had a stellar career since then, opening various restaurants in various cities around the country, and began perfecting his chocolate making skills in really small batch limited markets. And we're going to hear a little bit more about that tonight. Thanks for being with us, Chris.
My pleasure.
Ryan, thank you for being here also. Ryan Maybee really has changed the cocktail culture with the Manifesto speakeasy that no doubt you've been to and you've had to text with your phone to get in. At least I do. It's the only way they'll let me in. Classically inspired cocktails using old, fresh and home ingredients. Lots of national reviews, really well regarded. Bartender of the Year in 2013, co-founder of the Paris of the Plains Cocktail Festival, and used his expertise to help resurrect the iconic J. Rieger & Co. Rieger's 1924 Maine, which no doubt you'll all have eaten in. What a terrific restaurant that is. So thanks, folks, for being with us here, and we're really pleased now to have this conversation about chocolate and about whiskey and its history and having some tastings and so forth. So welcome to our living room. So chocolate consistently became part of the US Army diet after about 1907, when it was considered then part of the emergency rations. And so during the Great War, there'd be vacuum-sealed one-pound packs provided, which would have in there evaporated beef powder cooked with parched wheat, sweet chocolate, and salt and pepper. And then during the war, there would be, rations often sent from home, which then would carry with them chocolate, gifts from home. In fact, during the Christmas truce of 1914, it was one of the things that initiated people sharing chocolates with each other was the packets which were sent from home, used as a morale booster in lots of places. The US Army Quartermaster Corps would ship 20 to 40 pound blocks of chocolate to Europe to be then cut up for distribution amongst the troops, often used then to encourage, you know, not as a pacifier as such, but certainly as something which then fostered goodwill amongst the troops. The demand was so great that candy makers began experimenting with fillers, with putting wafers, with raisins, with nuts and other things, which gives rise to today's, you know, more gooey bars that you find. A popular treat for soldiers, as you'll see then in the images which are behind us here, this image here of men which stand in there, they're drinking chocolate in this one. We're going to talk about a little about that. YMCA, who would use chocolate as part of their, what they would provide to troops. Women serving chocolate in this picture here. And then I think this is a great photograph here. 50,000 pounds of chocolate, which was being sent to France from the US. That's quite a collection. So, René, chocolate has a long history in Europe, of which is the home of World War One. When I think of chocolate, I think of Swiss. You know, that my experience is that's some of the best chocolate. So what is it that makes Swiss chocolate so special?
Well, Switzerland was, they had a couple key roles in really making chocolate, refining chocolate into the bars that we think of now. In 1890, around the Rudolf Lindt developed the first conch. And conching is the process where they take the chocolate, and it is chocolate, it has the ingredients already mixed in, and they actually work it back and forth underneath a granite roller. And in that process, you're creating friction and heat. And the idea was to refine it that much further so that you got a really silky, smooth chocolate. What Rudolf Lindt didn't realize, he was also getting airflow through that chocolate. So he was taking out, he was oxidizing the chocolate, he was taking out some of the volatiles. That friction was actually caramelizing some of the sugars in the chocolate. So Swiss chocolate does tend to have a more caramely flavor because of that long conch time. So they conch for up to 72 hours, they'll conch their chocolate. So that was one of the key things that Switzerland provided for chocolate. And then the Swiss invented milk chocolate. So Daniel Peter, also about the same time, was the first one to ever incorporate milk powder into chocolate itself. He was father-in-law was Joseph Caille, who was a big chocolate maker still. Caille is one of the big Swiss chocolate manufacturers. So he had the chocolate background, but then he was also neighbors with Henry Nestle, who had just developed this baby cereal that used evaporated milk. And so he combined the two components to make the first milk chocolate. So Switzerland has had a really important role in the overall chocolate making history.
Yeah, Swiss chocolate, when I've eaten it, it just seems to be so smooth and melts. It seems to melt differently.
It does. And in that process, that conching process, you're actually, like I said, it's almost like you're polishing the chocolate molecule or the chocolate pieces. And so you're making a really, really fine emulsified chocolate. The cocoa butter, the fat in it is all kind of combined and emulsified into one unified bar. So the melt is great. The snap when you bite into it's really nice. And conching is something that I think most chocolate manufacturers or all chocolate manufacturers do, but the Swiss have always done it for a much longer time than many other parts of the world.
So what about you at Andres? What have you done? What's your approach to keep that tradition alive? How is it that you've made your chocolate a superior chocolate?
You know, I mean, most importantly, we use the best possible ingredients that we can find. I mean, Peter, like I said, who developed or founded milk chocolate, he collaborated with Nestle. Nestle ended up buying Peter's and came to the U.S. and set up a manufacturing facility here in the U.S. making Swiss chocolate or making chocolate in the Swiss art form. My grandfather, when he immigrated in 55, knew of Peter's. At that time, getting imported chocolate was much more complicated and wasn't readily available. So he started using Peter's from the very beginning. So now we use a variety of different chocolates, some imported and some being Peter's. But most importantly, just making sure that we stay as traditional as possible, but then always using the best possible ingredients, making sure that we never put any preservatives, additives, things like that into our chocolates.
So do you have a similar 72-hour sort of process?
Well, we don't manufacture our own chocolate. We buy chocolate, so we blend a variety of different chocolates. Our truffles are all made with from a company called Felclean, which is a small Swiss manufacturer. They do phenomenal chocolates. The chocolate almonds that are on the tasting tray are made from our single origin dark chocolate from that manufacturer. But so we blend to make our own chocolate or our signature chocolate, but we don't actually do the conching process at Andres.
Good. So today when we think of chocolate, we generally think of something that we eat, but for most of its history, chocolate was drunk, at least in some form. Rather than being a junk food, which is often what we think of it today. It really has had a storied history and considered a bit of a luxury. And it has a complex blend of substances, something more than 400 compounds, I understand. One of those is phenylethylamine, which is the closest thing to the love drug. You know that, you know the feeling like when you're in love with somebody and you get the butterflies in your stomach and you think of them all the time, and you know that it's really like you're wanting to be with them a whole lot. Well, your body releases a hormone called phenylethylamine, which is also found in chocolate. So there's another reason to be eating chocolate, is that it can resurrect your love life. And so for centuries, chocolate was considered an aphrodisiac, a bit of a love drug, perhaps with good reason. And so as we look at these images here, we'll see some of those, the ways in which chocolate was, and drinking chocolate or cocoa or cacao was advertised. It takes on some of these images here. So here I love this one here, Baker's Cocoa, robust men like Baker's Cocoa, cocoa of high chocolate, or this one here, Cadbury's Cocoa makes strong men stronger, which I think is a beauty. The most refreshing, nutritious and satisfying of all cocoas. Or this one here, which is sort of a provocative sort of scene. It's made with two stirs, is the slogan that this one comes from. Or perhaps my favourite is this one, Cadbury's Pure. It's absolutely pure. Sustains against fatigue, increases muscular strength, gives physical endurance, and the best of all, staying power. And then nothing could top off this one. He comes first. In a sense, it's the Viagra of the 20th century. Which perhaps gives different meaning to the Catherine Hepburn says, "What you see before me, by my friend, is a result of a lifetime of chocolate."
That's all true.
That's why I got into chocolate.
So Chris and René, talk to us about chocolate in community life. You know, it does have a storied history. It plays a part. Talk to us about what's the role of chocolate in community life?
I think one thing that I've seen a big shift in, I've only been in the business for about 10, 11 years, and I always used to travel to Europe and see how they can enjoy on a daily basis very small amounts of things. You know, it's just a little great luxury of the day. And that's kind of what I see chocolate and Americans gravitating towards, is enjoying these small moments of the day. It's an affordable luxury. You can go in and, you know, we have people that come into the shop and they get one piece every day at the end of their lunch. And it's, you know, it's a religion to them. You know, and seeing America, not just in chocolate as well, but in with bread, cheese, you know, all these, this great artisan movement, Americans are really paying attention to that as a great part of their day.
So you commented there about high quality small bites, mm-hmm. as though there seems to be a shift that's taking place.
Yeah, I think so. You know, you no longer need a king-size jumbo 4-pound candy bar. We can pack as much richness and flavor and decadence into a small little piece that's not a lot of calories, and you still feel like you're eating something sinful, you know, and getting away with it.
Yeah, yeah, which is something we all seek to do.
Every day.
I remember as a child, and our dad would buy a block of chocolate, and it would be fruit and nut, that was the favorite, and break it up, and then we'd have just a few pieces whilst we watched TV, maybe every couple of weeks. It was a big deal for the family. And in those days in Australia, it was Cadbury's milk chocolate fruit and nut bar. That was the which I can occasionally get at World Market or such places. But of course, Christopher Elbow or Andres is the preferred treat in our house.
Yeah, I think, another thing you just touched on is, food brings people together. So sharing these moments of, people getting a box of chocolates and unwrapping it, they bring it out for dessert at the end of a meal. It becomes a conversation piece. It becomes part of the night, part of the evening. That experience alone is something that should be treasured.
Yeah. In fact, even the experience of purchasing chocolate is something like that.
Mm-hmm.
I have enjoyed purchasing Christopher Elbow chocolates by selecting them at the store and then having them packed in a box and wrapped then as the gift or as a treat to take home. So there's something about the experience even of doing that then adds to the experience of eating that.
Yeah, it's a very, a lot of pomp and circumstances go into the packaging and that whole experience when you walk in the door to taking it home at night. It's an ongoing thing. It just doesn't end when you're in the shop.
Yeah. So I understand the chocolate was brought to Europe by the Spaniards in the 17th century and became popular amongst the elites more as a luxury drink. In fact, if you've traveled to Spain, I haven't experienced it elsewhere, but I have in Spain where we'd go to a chocolate bar where we would, at late at night, get a cup of chocolate, which I thought would be like Milo or Ovaltine, but it was actually like melted milk chocolate, really thick, in a cup. I cannot imagine how many calories were in it. And that we would have something to dip in it and then eat that. And it was extraordinary. Oh my goodness. Just a fantastic experience. Something similar to the cups of, well, in fact, it was much thicker than what we were drinking outside here. So it was considered a luxury drink, more expensive than chocolate, was popular particularly in Catholic countries, whereas in Protestant countries, coffee was more popular. Perhaps something to do with the economies of those places. In this picture here, we'll see some Jesuits who ran cacao plantations in the New World. The photo shows a chocolatier or a cloisters where they would use for making chocolate for enjoyment of then making it, then eating it, drinking it. Because chocolate was so popular amongst the Catholics, it led to a debate about this question, was it a drink or a food? Because then, can it be consumed during fasting time? So over the past 100 years, the art of chocolate has changed. How has it changed, Renee and Chris? What's changed in the last 100 years in how chocolate is being made?
It's a pretty big span, 100 years. I think I can maybe speak to the last 10 or 15
sure.
years. One thing that I really got excited about as I got into chocolate was all of a sudden you can get this single origin chocolate, much like wine or coffee, one varietal from a specific plantation in Venezuela or one of the great cacao growing regions. And that to me has been, I think, the biggest shift that I've seen. We can sit down and taste 20 different chocolates and they'll all taste the same. It's no longer just, here's a milk chocolate, a white chocolate, or a dark chocolate. And we utilize a lot of those in our confections, and they all taste so different. I'm really excited when people come into the shop and they buy our single origin chocolates and they taste them side by side and they're just amazed at how different they taste. And I feel like we're only on the tip of the iceberg here and exploring that that kind of phenomenon.
Yeah. Reda, you talked about the fantastic process that's used to create really the very best of chocolates. What's changed? That doesn't seem to be as common with lots of, with mass production of chocolate. How have you seen it change?
Well, and I mean, 100 years ago, I think a lot of the reason why you drank a lot of chocolate was because that chocolate wasn't that smooth, silky, bar that we're used to now. It was kind of grainy, and it wasn't the cocoa butter, the oils that are in chocolate wasn't emulsified well, and so it just wasn't really nice to eat just as pure chocolate. And so that conching process and just the manufacturing techniques changed pretty dramatically over the last 100 years to create something that's really exceptionally silky. And when you bite into it, the melt, and I mean, the chocolate industry for a while used to put, and they're still compound coatings, they'll put vegetable fats in some chocolate, and they'll do different things to cheapen it or to make it easier to use. And like Chris was saying, I think you're seeing less and less of that because people are really embracing chocolate is a whole experience, not just that it's sweet. They love the intricacies of the dark chocolate. I mean, 30 years ago, Andre's probably sold 20% dark and 80% milk. And over the last 30 years, that we have seen a gradual shift where we're almost at 50-50 wow. now. And dark is starting to even overtake milk in some aspects for a lot of different reasons. But what Chris touched on, I mean, it's people are embracing those single origin chocolates or the intricacies of that you get in dark chocolate that you'll never find in milk because milk tends to be, it's sweeter and the milk kind of takes away from those different flavor profiles that you get in darks. So that would be.
And I think dark chocolate has gotten a bad rap. You know, we've had to overcome this kind of notion that dark chocolate is bitter. And I don't like to use that word bitter. It has a negative connotation to me. It's one of your flavors that you taste on your tongue. And I love bitter things, but the general public, I think, hears bitter and they already start making a face before they even taste it. You know, a very good high quality dark chocolate is not bitter. It's very flavorful. It can be, you know, it can range from fruity to earthy to nutty. And that's, I guess, part of an education process that, you know, people have had to relearn what they think dark chocolate is.
Well, my wife tells me that it's health food.
It is a health food.
Well, I tell her it's an aphrodisiac.
Perfect.
You combine it with almonds and it's a multivitamin.
There you go, multivitamin. Yeah. Indeed.
It was W.C. Fields who said, always carry a flagon of whiskey in case of a snake bite, and furthermore, always carry a small steak. Whiskey was one of the many alcoholic options available to soldiers and officers during the Great War. There were other types of hard liquors available, and the troops used whiskey for recreational, for morale, for medical purposes during the war. In fact, my wife's grandmother reminded me that she always had whiskey on hand for medicinal purposes. Lots of first aid treatment in their home, I'm sure. While beer and rum and vodka were rationed to the troops, whiskey wasn't as available to the troops, and so it would be often given as gift or smuggled or purchased. There was poor quality available, referred to as barbed wire whiskies, and better quality whiskies like Johnny Walker were celebrated. Old Bran Orkney, which soldiers often called officers only whiskey, was more expensive during the war, in part because governments tried to subdue consumption by increased alcohol taxes. By 1918, a bottle of whiskey in Britain was costing £1, which is five times more than at the beginning of the war. So tremendous increase. You'll see here some images of whiskey being consumed by soldiers, by men here at a table. These two guys here drinking whiskey together. These guys in a room celebrating with whiskey. And my favorite, this one here. I just, what a great holiday card that would make. It appears that like chocolate, whiskey also seemed to make things last. People, in fact, here's a photograph of Richard Overton, born in 1906. He's a World War II vet. In 2013, he was the oldest living veteran in the United States. And he told Fox News, America's most trusted news source. Quote, he'd likely spend on this his birthday, his 13th birthday. It wasn't 113, it was 109. He would spend the day on his perch in his East Austin home with a cigar nestled in his right hand and perhaps a cup of whiskey, stiffened coffee nearby. So not only did he enjoy whiskey, but it was evident that he was a Protestant as well. He went on to say that whiskey is good medicine, it keeps your muscles tender. And then here is a British World War I veteran. In 2009, he was 113, thought to be the world's oldest man, and he quipped that his longevity was due to cigarettes, whiskey, and wild, wild women. Love makes the world go round. Not at all. Whiskey makes it go round twice as fast, says Compton Mackenzie, the British intelligence agent during World War I. So, Ryan, talk to us about the history of the Rieger since World War I, the history of whiskey in Kansas City. That's a pretty important and interesting story.
Yeah, absolutely. The first thing you think of when you think of the Rieger is the restaurant that's downtown, but it was located in the original Rieger Hotel, which was built in 1915 to coincide with the building of Union Station, which was built in 1914. And it was a traveler's hotel, at the time considered a budget hotel. In that time, if you were traveling and staying in hotels, you were fairly wealthy, and hotels were fairly expensive and opulent. And the Rieger was one of the first of a class of hotels that was considered a budget hotel of its time, which is kind of ironic to think because it was, you know, clad in marble and beautiful tile floor and everything, which is still there and still intact. But it was really a more affordable hotel at that time period because train travel was becoming much more popular. So that was, you know, when I first was in that building and started Manifesto in 2009, that was all that I knew of the Rieger name and of the Rieger Hotel was just back to 1915. But when I had the opportunity to take over the restaurant, I wanted to know more about the name, more about where it came from, how it came to be, and accidentally stumbled onto the history of J. Rieger & Company whiskey. And I had no idea that there was actually a distillery located in the West Bottoms that dated back to 1887. And it was founded by Jacob Rieger at that time, which was right after Kansas became the first state to enact prohibition, 38 years ahead of federal prohibition. So they were very progressive.
Ahead of that time.
And the West Bottoms, the area of the West Bottoms, was just across the state line. It became known in 1881 as the wettest block in the world because Kansas made drinking illegal. And so all of a sudden, in that part of the West Bottoms, you had casinos and saloons and brothels and a distillery pop up, and it was that was the Wild West. But J. Rieger & Company became very, very successful as a mail order whiskey distributor. They were shipping their bottles all over the country, and they ended up having over 100 products, and they had many whiskeys. They had gin, they had cordials, they had a whole line of bottlings that they sent all over the country, and built on that success, the founder's son, Alexander, then built the hotel in 1915.
But, and I understand then down at West Bottoms, there were more than 24 bars which faced Kansas.
right, Stan, just come on over here.
Yeah. Isn't that fun that when you go down State Line Road and on the left side is Mission Hills Country Club and the right-hand side is the Carriage the Carriage Club, which was the bar of Mission Hills Country Club,
right?
Until they permitted alcohol consumption.
Oh, they were the first to ban it and the last to like really get on board with repealing it. I mean, I don't experience this. I haven't experienced this personally, but I've heard many stories about even as you know recently as the 1980s when you were flying over certain parts of Kansas, you couldn't have a drink in your hand on the airplane. They had to take the drink away before you crossed over Kansas airspace.
Yeah.
That's kind of remarkable, if you think
about
it.
Yeah. You know? Yeah, thank goodness those days are gone.
Exactly.
So, Ryan, you're the 2013 Bartender of the Year, an acclaimed mixologist. If we were to take something away from us with us today about making a cocktail utilizing whiskey, what are the building blocks to do that? How do we create something which is spectacular?
Whiskey is such a broad category. You can really do absolutely anything with it because whiskey really embodies American whiskey, obviously, which is bourbon and straight rye. You know, those are you know, world-class whiskeys, which fortunately the government has gone to lengths to regulate it to a point to where it can ensure quality to compete with whiskeys like Scottish whiskey and Irish whiskey. You know, so there are some really world-class whiskeys, but they differ so greatly. You know, bourbon is really its own thing. It's primarily corn and has to go through its own process and quality, you know, quality assurances. Just like rye, rye is drier, more floral, more spicy. And then if you compare that to like Scotch or Irish, you know, it's a completely different ballgame because then you're basing the whiskey on barley malt. So, you know, really when it comes to building a cocktail, it depends on the whiskey that you want to start with. But to kind of tie it back in with chocolate, you know, you can absolutely marry the two together. I started bartending in 1999, and I think I made more chocolate martinis every night than anything else. It was, you know, the cocktail movement that we see today wasn't really happening at that time, but it was just sort of burgeoning, and chocolatinis and appletinis and that sweet kind of cocktail was very popular, and it really led into what we see today as the whole, you know, cocktail renaissance, as some people call it. But now what's really great is, you know, while that began with using vodka as a base and using all these modifiers, all these secondary flavorings that were typically sweet, now we're seeing the use of all these other categories of spirits. And whiskey is, without question, the fastest growing of any category.
On our little ticket book that we have, there's a couple of recipes on here. One is the Christopher Elbow's chocolate and whiskey liqueur, and the other is the 4th Regiment cocktail. Do you want to speak to either of these and what is, you know, what makes these fabulous?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I haven't had Christopher Elbow's. I don't know why you didn't bring me one. I mean, the 4th Regiment cocktail is a classic, which was first published in Jacques Straub's book in 1914. And it's really just a riff on a Manhattan. If you look at the structure of that cocktail with 1 ounce whiskey, 1 ounce Italian or sweet vermouth, back then in 1914 when this book was published, Italian vermouth was generally what we know today as sweet vermouth, the red, darker, more rich vermouth, whereas French vermouth was lighter and drier. Now you've got producers in both countries making both styles, and so it's there's a little bit more option there. But back then, if it said Italian vermouth, you would just associate that with sweet. And then using both orange bitters and Angostura, which was incredibly common, or Peychaud's, which was a little less common at the time, but still readily available. The celery bitters, I think, is an interesting one because that's something that you rarely see in classic cocktails. Mm. And it's just an ingredient that's come back in recent years that was only, it was fairly obscure at the time, but now you're seeing all kinds of producers bring back these kind of long-lost products, which is allowing bartenders to really make beautiful, complex cocktails. So the 4th Regiment cocktail is really a riff on a simple Manhattan. And I think it's really interesting, too, how we talked about in the very beginning, or you spoke about rationing whiskey to the soldiers. And that practice really carried over from the British Royal Navy. They sort of founded that practice during colonial times where they were rationing rum to their soldiers. Rum. And if you don't know where the term proof comes from, everyone talks about the proof of alcohol in the bottle. That term comes from the fact that they were actually carrying barrels of rum on the ship right next to barrels of gunpowder. And they would test it to make sure they got good rum from the Caribbean producers. They would actually pour it over the gunpowder, and if it's still lit, that was proof that it was good, strong rum. Yeah. That's where that term came from.
There's another tip to try at home.
I don't. No, we play with fire a lot of Manifesto, but I don't recommend that.
Yeah, we typically do that around the 4th of July.
Yeah. But yeah, so it's the rationing of whiskey during that time period, during World War I, was kind of a carryover from the practice that was begun by the British Royal Navy. Mm.
There was another great friend of Kansas City, Winston Churchill, who said that water was not fit to drink. To make it palatable, we had to add whiskey. By diligent effort, I learned to like it. So, Ryan, you've commented there about you commented about vodka and whiskey. It seems as though, from what I've read, that vodka sales are slipping to whiskey sales. Is that something that you're seeing? How do you account for that?
It's definitely happening. And recent reports are showing that whiskey as a general category and bourbon and rye as a more specific category are growing at a much more rapid pace than any other category, and vodka sales have slipped. You know, I never like to say, oh, I don't like vodka, or I never really try to steer people away from vodka if that's what they really want. But vodka blew up in the 1950s through the 1970s due to heavy marketing, mainly through a marketing firm called Hubline and a gentleman named John Martin, who was just very savvy, based out of Hollywood. He ended up getting Smirnoff vodka placed in the very first James Bond film, you know, which was where the phrase shaken, not stirred was coined, and it just took off. And by 1972, vodka sales exceeded whiskey sales in America for the first time. It took over whiskey, and part of it was Smirnoff's campaign of it will leave you breathless. They actually had that on billboards and in magazines, and the whole idea was it has no flavor, has no aroma like gin or like whiskey, so you could go out to lunch and have three or four martinis and your boss wouldn't know, right? Of course, we know that's not true, but that was their marketing campaign, and it was really brilliant, you know? But I think what's cool about the fact that whiskey is now making such a strong comeback is that, you know, bourbon and rye are American spirits. And the regulation that goes into producing them, requiring that you use a minimum amount of corn in bourbon and a minimum amount of rye in rye and use brand new charred American white oak barrels and age it for a minimum amount of time and bottle it at a certain proof, it really ensures quality. And it ensures a lot of flavor, you know, and I think that's what's really great about it. Well, vodka took off at that time period because of marketing. You know, whiskey is taking off because I think there's a strong sense of pride in it being our national spirit.
Right. It's sort of, there's a lot of patriotism associated with that,
yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it tastes better.
Yeah.
It tastes like something.
It tastes like something, right.
Chris, you've got a new partnership with Häagen-Dazs, which is coming up. Why don't you tease us with what's happening there?
Thank you.
Well, this is kind of actually hearkening back on the conversation we were having about, you know, in America discovering, you know, or backtracking a little bit to artisan food, artisan producers. And we were one of six artisans selected to create and collaborate on a flavor with Häagen-Dazs, which actually has a great story. I was very reticent going into this that, hey, here's this big, you know, commercially produced ice cream manufacturer, you know, kind of is a little bit of the antithesis of what we stand for. But as we had some more conversations and got into it, you know, Häagen-Dazs was started by one guy in a shop in Brooklyn. He selected that name because it sounded, you know, like something extravagant, you know, and their mission was to create the best ice cream using the best ingredients. And it's still very clear to this day. So they had our turtles, which is something we're kind of known for, is taking a classic confection and turning it on its head with a little twist. So we do, you know, some soft caramel, roasted pecans with dark chocolate and some chilies. And we've kind of deconstructed that into this ice cream. And within a week or two, it should start seeing it on the shelf.
Yeah, fantastic. So where can we get some of that?
You should start getting it at any grocery store that sells Häagen-Dazs within, and it's already hit the coast and it's kind of matriculating in.
Yeah, so. How fabulous is that? And René, you've got a new experiment with a wine bar, wine and chocolate.
Talk to us. Well, we, you know, it's something that we had plans drawn up in 2007. We expanded our production facility and gave us some space to put in this chocolate coffee and wine bar, and we feel like all those three components go so well together. And we use bar very loosely because we don't want to be a bar, but we love that European feel where people come in for lunch, they have a glass of wine, something light to eat, or on the way home from work, they'll, you know, grab a pastry and a nice glass of bubbles. Something very simple, but we're not open late. We just want to provide something new and different to the whole Andres feel. So so like I said, in 2007, we had those plans drawn up. The economy tanked, and we said, you know, is this really the best time to drop a bunch of money in a wine bar? We've held out until last year. We've seen a lot of development around our area on Main Street. Yeah. We felt like it was It was the right time to go forward with it, and opened about 4 months ago and had tons of success. Been really excited about the reaction, the design, which Chem Studios was our architect, and they designed something that's absolutely phenomenal, super, really modern, but still has that warmth that Andres has always had. So we're really excited about it.
One of the things that strikes me about Kansas City is there's lots of local folks done good stories. And here's three of those stories here, what great stories they are. Now, you've been sitting there with your little samples. We have a medical program coming up soon, and this cup gives me some ideas about what we might do for that. But I wonder if you can take us through, let's begin with the chocolate, take us through the tasting, and then we'll move to the whiskey, if you can lead us through that experience. So, Chris, do you want to lead off?
So, you know, chocolate with whiskey, with a lot of great spirits is my favorite thing. People will kill me, but I'm not a fan of chocolate and red wine. Yeah. I just don't think it's a great combination for what it does to the wine. I don't think the sweetness works, you know. But the caveat, don't let me tell you, if you like drinking wine and eating chocolate, then you should do it all night long. I know nothing. But when I pair, when I go out and do things and pair, want to pair chocolate with something, I pair it with a spirit, a cocktail, anything from tequila to whiskey. So what I did here today was think about one of my favorite drinks, which is a very well-made Manhattan. And I use what's called an Amarena cherry, which is a candied Italian cherry, and that's what I put in my Manhattans. So we took a little bit of Amarena cherry, made a ganache out of the syrup that it comes in, and enclosed it in dark chocolate. So not necessarily to compete with the whiskey, but to complement and maybe evoke that cocktail.
Good, good, good. So will we wait before we eat? Do you want us to have it with the whiskey?
You should have it with the whiskey.
And then we have...
Those are matted. So it's a single origin dark chocolate almond, and again, what Chris said, I think dark chocolate and whiskey, they just complement each other so well. What's great about this single origin chocolate is that it has a lot of fruitiness to it, a little bit of acidity. It's a really, really nice, it's a 64%. I do feel like dark chocolate, as you get more and more intense, it does complement the whiskey that much better. And then the caramelized shell on the outside of the almond, and then the really nicely roasted nut. I think everything about it just complements the whiskey really well.
I feel a little bit like Pavlov's dog here. I'm salivating as they're talking. So, Ryan, why don't you step us through then, comment about that, and then let's eat this bloody stuff.
Absolutely. I agree with Chris. I'm not a huge fan of pairing chocolate with red wine. I feel like chocolate overpowers red wine 100% of the time. It's so sweet, it just overpowers the nuances that you get out of a dry, wet red wine, and you usually want something that's going to, you know, kind of butt heads with it and stand up to each other. And I feel like spirits in general do that, and whiskey is a great way to go. So our whiskey here, the J. Rieger & Co. Kansas City whiskey, this is a blend of two different whiskeys that are both aged 8 years old. One is a light corn whiskey, the other one is a straight rye whiskey. And then we've added a little bit of a 15-year-old Oloroso sherry to it, which just gives the whiskey a little bit of richness and sweetness in the mid palate, and also has a if you're familiar with sherry, has a pretty profound nutty kind of characteristic. So I think it's going to pair really well with the almonds. I think that's going to be fantastic.
Right. All righty. So what should we do?
Eat and
have
drink.
A sip. Eat.
Eat and drink.
Sip. Eat. All righty. So please unscrew your jars and enjoy for the next few minutes.
That works very well. Mm-hmm. You can think of worse ways to spend an evening.
Mm-hmm.
good stuff.
Wow. Ladies and gentlemen, we're drawing to the close of our evening. We're grateful that you're at the National World War I Museum, which is the nation's museum for the commemoration of the Great War, the second oldest collecting institution of its type in the world, with the most comprehensive collection. And in December, we were designated by Congress, signed into law by President Obama, as the National World War I Memorial. So that's a bit of a tip of the hat to Kansas City. Receiving no federal funding and a gem of Kansas City, where the number one rated attraction by TripAdvisor in Kansas City. And we need to keep it that way. So we'd invite you to write a review on TripAdvisor when you have the opportunity. Please join me in thanking René Bollier, Christopher Albo, and Ryan Maybee. We also want to thank our sponsors, The Pitch, the Kansas City Neighborhood Tourism Development Fund, the Volunteers Fund of the National World War I Museum, Central States Beverage, Glazers, Prairie Creek Beverages, Joe Terranova of Beam Sun Tours, and donors of the National World War I Museum for their support. And we're pleased to share that the next few in our series, we have Chow Challenge on April the 23rd, Tattoos and World War I on July 23rd, and look forward to cider in the fall. Ladies and gentlemen, we're so grateful for your support. Make sure you visit the places here. Make sure you visit the establishments that our guests operate. And we're grateful for your attendance, and thank you and good night.